Hi, Russ of Aquarium Max Pets here. I've been culturing this strain of Daphnia for over 12 years, improving my methods over that time. And today I'm going to share my current culture methods with you. First, let's talk about where to get a starter culture of Daphnia. You could certainly collect some in a lake or pond, if you can find them, but you would run the risk of collecting predators or other unwanted hitchhikers along with the Daphnia. So, in many cases, buying them may be your best option. Daphnia can be sold both as dry epipia, which are egg cases resistant to a lot of environmental extremes, such as drying, high and low temperatures, etc. And these epipia will hatch when offered the right conditions. Or you can buy Daphnia as the active live Daphnia, like you see in the video. The advantages of purchasing them as the dry epipia are, while they are in that stage, they're very resistant, like I mentioned, to many conditions and can therefore be shipped very cheaply with little risk of damage. The main disadvantage of epipia is that it can sometimes be difficult to provide appropriate conditions for hatching them. An advantage of purchasing the active live Daphnia is the speed and relative ease with which you can usually get a culture going. The disadvantage of active live Daphnia are that they're more sensitive than the epipia or egg cases, and since they must be shipped in water, they're typically more expensive to ship. Water's heavy. The Daphnia that I culture very rarely produce epipia, so I only offer them as active Daphnia. Some sites where you can buy Daphnia from include aquabid.com, eBay, Amazon, or if you're in the continental USA, my website, aquariummax.com. So let's talk about setting up the tank. The type of tank depends on how many Daphnia you want to produce. You can very successfully culture Daphnia in a half gallon or a gallon jar, and I have a video specifically about that up here. But in this video, I will focus on using a larger tank or bucket or tub for much higher yields. It is also an excellent idea to have more than one culture in case your original culture crashes. In my case, I have a 20 gallon tank as a culture, a 40 gallon tank, and a 1 gallon backup jar Daphnia culture. I've only had a few culture crashes since I started working with this particular strain of Daphnia more than 12 years ago, but I am definitely glad that I had backup cultures going. So really, many different types of containers can work, tubs, buckets, and aquariums. So now let's talk about aeration. People often ask about aeration, and while it is not strictly necessary, it does seem to boost production and also helps keep the fine particles of food that the Daphnia need in suspension in the water column. I do recommend an airline without an airstone, as fine bubbles from an airstone can lodge within the body cavity of the Daphnia, trapping them at the surface of the water where they die. So just a trickle of coarse bubbles, as you see here, is ideal. Just keep in mind that a little flow is good, too much can be a problem. Room temperatures are typically sufficient, but my basement is pretty cool, so I heat the 40-gallon tank to around 78 degrees, which seems to increase the speed at which the Daphnia multiply. That said, there's no heater in the 20 gallon or in the gallon jar culture, and they're doing all right as well. So usually room temperature is perfectly fine. You'll notice I have a cover on the larger tanks here. It helps to reduce evaporation and retain heat, but it's not strictly necessary. It does give you more options about where you're going to place the lighting. Daphnia really don't need more than ambient lighting, but they are attracted to light, especially after a feeding. So I find that using a small aquarium light on one side of the tank makes it extremely easy to harvest them efficiently, but more on harvesting later. So let's get into what to feed your Daphnia. They can successfully be fed on a wide variety of foods, and I have used many of them. For the last couple of years, my go-to food has been a mixture of dried hematococcus algae and active dried yeast. That's exactly the same yeast you use for baking bread. Precise proportions are not critical. It's probably about 20 parts of the dry yeast to 1 part hematococcus algae, and then I add both of those to some purified water, mix them up thoroughly before adding the resultant liquid to the tank. You can use yeast dissolved in water without the algae, and it works fine by itself, but I do seem to get better results when I add the algae, and the astaxanthin in the algae is a natural color enhancer that gets passed on to your fish when they eat the Daphnia. If you're interested in purchasing some of the hematococcus algae to mix your own food, I'll put a link down in the description, or you can purchase pre-mixed food from me, either separately from or along with a Daphnia starter culture at my website, aquariummax.com. When you feed your Daphnia, add enough of the food to the tank to make the water slightly cloudy and wait to feed until the water is clear again. This may take a day to a few days, depending on the population density in your culture and how much you feed and so on. It's generally better to underfeed than overfeed, especially with a new culture. As the culture grows, you can gradually increase the amount of food that you add. I also add algae pellets to the tank. The snails that you see in here munch on those, and as they do, fine particles of the algae pellets get into the water. The Daphnia probably eat some of those directly, but they also encourage the growth of microorganisms in the water column that also serve as food for the Daphnia. While we're talking about snails providing supplemental food for the Daphnia, I should mention that there are other reasons that I have snails in the Daphnia culture. They help keep the walls of the aquarium from being thickly coated with algae. I've cultured Daphnia with and without snails, and I do feel that the culture in general with snails is more stable. There are those that state that a Daphnia culture without snails may be more prolific, and that may very well be true. But I think the stability that they offer to the culture more than makes up for any difference in fecundity of the Daphnia. And, well, to be honest, I never really run out of Daphnia. If I sell a whole bunch of Daphnia, all I have to do is wait a few days and they're back. So let's talk about maintenance. I try to do weekly water changes on the culture of about 10 to 20%. I try to get a lot of detritus off of the bottom of the tank when I do that because the snails make quite a mess, as do the Daphnia, and the frequent water changes really seem to boost production of the Daphnia. So people ask me whether you should use tank water from an established aquarium or tap water to do the water changes. Since Daphnia tend to be sensitive to heavy metals and other contaminants that are commonly found in tap water, many people recommend using water that they siphon out of an established aquarium. This can work very well, but beware of introducing hydra to your Daphnia culture. Since hydra can and often do live in aquariums in low densities without being noticed, it wouldn't be difficult to accidentally introduce one into your Daphnia tank. Hydra can reproduce asexually and will absolutely thrive on a steady diet of Daphnia. So it just takes one hydra to destroy your culture over time. Just something to keep in mind. Personally, I use tap water treated with dechlorinator for water changes. With my Daphnia and my tap water, this works great, but it may not work for you, as tap water composition, of course, varies widely with location. Not only that, but Daphnia species and strains can be very different in terms of what they can handle. Now let's talk about harvesting. As I mentioned before, Daphnia tend to be positively phototactic, or in other words, they're attracted to light, particularly once food is added to the culture water. Every time I feed, I notice within a short time, if the Daphnia weren't gathered in a cloud under the light, pretty soon they are. To harvest them, I just use a turkey baster and fill a small container with some of the tank water, and then I use a small fine mesh net to scoop up as many Daphnia as I need into that small container. I'm ready to go. So now for some additional Daphnia Q&A. People often want to know how quickly Daphnia can reproduce, how quickly their culture can get going to the point where they can feed from it. Well, Daphnia tend to reproduce in good conditions through parthenogenesis, which means that females give birth to more females without mating, and they continue to reproduce very quickly. A Daphnia can reproduce within a week to 10 days of being born, sometimes less than that. And so you can very quickly go from one Daphnia to 10 Daphnia to 100 Daphnia to 1,000 Daphnia within a few weeks. And if you start with 100 or so, you'll have thousands within a month or so, as long as you're taking good care of them. The key to breeding Daphnia is just taking good care of them, and they'll do the rest. People wonder sometimes if they can use a metal bucket or a tub like that, like a galvanized tub, to culture Daphnia. And my answer is that since Daphnia are sensitive to metal contamination, I recommend using glass or plastic to culture them. I've never used anything other than glass or plastic, and I've used both with success. Another very common question I get is, how do you keep from siphoning up Daphnia when you do a water change? Well, to be honest, I just try to put the siphon in a darker area of the tank with fewer Daphnia, and I know I end up siphoning some out. You could put a very fine mesh around the opening of the siphon tube, like a stocking, one of those stretchy stockings, but that would prevent you from siphoning out larger particles of detritus, and it would very likely clog very quickly. So I've just resigned myself to the fact that some Daphnia are going to be siphoned out. People often ask me an interesting question about which species I have. They say, do you have Daphnia magna or Daphnia pulex? Well, there are about 200 species in the genus Daphnia and hundreds more closely related cladocerans outside the genus, and I'm honestly not sure which one I have. If they produced epipia, or the egg cases, with any frequency, I could probably look at those to figure it out, but they don't. They were sold to me years ago simply as Russian red Daphnia, with no scientific name. For what it's worth, the seller I bought my starter culture from all those years ago shared this possible origin story. The original Russian red Daphnia are said to have been collected from the alligator pool at the Moscow Zoo back in the 1960s. The seller didn't know if the tale was true or not, so of course, neither do I, but that's the story. If you have any other questions about Daphnia culture, please leave them down in the comments, and thanks for watching. I post videos every Friday with live streams or a short during the week as well. Please feel free to rate, share, comment, and if you haven't already,
subscribe.
And then tap the bell for all notifications so you don't miss my next video.